Guys, good morning. Good morning, Bentree. Those of you here with us in the room in Carrollton, those of you joining us online, we're going to be in Psalm 139 this morning. Let me just open us in prayer. Lord Jesus, we came here with nothing but what you've given us. You are so good. Your grace and your glory are matchless. Lord, I pray that you just bring a fresh fire, new wine this morning. Come and tell us something that we haven't heard before. Come and explain. Holy Spirit, speak through me. Let me be the conduit, Lord. Jesus, come and show us something new from your word. Lord, you're so good, the designer, a designer with purpose, and a matchless creator. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Who's read Psalm 139 before? Just raise your hand. My hope is that maybe you'll take something away from it that's a little bit different. This is a beautiful psalm, isn't it? Those of you who are familiar with it. It's beautiful, but scholars don't necessarily all agree on the genre in which Psalm 139 fits. I think we come to psalms thinking that they're all just songs. They're all worship songs that someone wrote a long time ago, but that's really not the case. Most scholars agree that Psalm 139 is what's called didactic poetry. It's poetry with a purpose. It's designed to teach you something. So the question is, what is it designed to teach you? As a man, I confess that I approach Psalms and I go, yes, this is beautiful, but what's it good for? What is Psalm 139 good for? So 6 years ago, before I became an elder, by the way, I'm not the pastor. I'm the chair of the elder board. If you're wondering, who is this person up here speaking? I'm the chairman of the elder board. I've been an elder for 5 years. 6 years ago, before I was an elder, I used to be able to avoid hard conversations. If there's something I don't want to talk about, I just go, oh, that's interesting, and then I move on. I can avoid a hard conversation. When you become an elder, you don't really get the privilege of doing that anymore. So those of you who are regular attenders at Bentree know that last year in February of 2018, we started having intercessory prayer or healing prayer down here at the front. I knew that that was going to happen in advance. In January of 2018, I was serving in the prayer room. Those of you who haven't been here a lot, you may have noticed there's a prayer room as you come into the crossing. If you have any prayer needs, there are elders and servants who are staffing that place up. And I remember in January of 2018, there being a particularly heavy prayer day. So I usually come home after serving in the prayer room and I just need to kind of take that emotional backpack off and go, wow, that there was a lot to that. But I had a thought, and I know now that this thought was from the Lord, January 2018, I had the thought, I wonder what I would say if someone came to me for prayer and said, I'm struggling with being attracted to someone of the same gender. I paused and I thought, yes, that would be interesting if that actually happened. So the next week, in February of 2018, we had our first intercessory prayer moment where people could come down and get prayer for healing, something physical or emotional or whatever it is. And I was standing right there and the first person came down to me and said, I've got a shoulder problem. We prayed for healing for his shoulder. Second person comes down with a parent and says, I'm struggling with being attracted to someone of the same gender and I don't want this thing in my life. I thought, what am I gonna say? Have you ever had that dream where you're about to sit for the Spanish final and you've never been to Spanish class? That's kind of the vibe that I was feeling. But something in me took over and I began to pray Psalm 139 over this person. And then the next month when we had healing prayer, I'm in the same place. Another person comes down with a parent and says, I'm struggling with being attracted to someone of the same gender and I don't want this thing in my life. Will you pray for me? And again, something rose up for me, and I prayed Psalm 139 over them. Psalm 139 is didactic. It's intended to be taught. But why is it so useful? It's because people feel unknown. People feel unseen. People feel misunderstood. And it's in Psalm 139 that we meet the knower, that we meet the seer, that we meet the understander. And we actually learn that he's pursuing us. It's not us who are pursuing him. He's pursuing us. So I grew up in a Christian school. I went to Second Baptist School in Houston, Texas from kindergarten through 12th grade, little sheltered bubble. I had to memorize Psalm 139 in school, and I've used it as a touchstone to pray for others ever since then. You know, it's important to pray Scripture and let it do its work. We pray from Scripture. We don't just make up beautiful things to say when we pray. We pray from Scripture because that's what our prayers are grounded in. That's where their authority and power comes from. I want to tell you something that is going to be a little bit of an embarrassing disclosure. So when I was in second grade, our class was given an art project assignment, and here's what the assignment was. The art project was to take a photograph of yourself and cut out your head from the photograph and paste it on a piece of construction paper. And then what you're supposed to do is draw around your head a body doing something that you want to be when you grow up. And so we took these projects and we posted them up on the wall in the second grade classroom, and there were a lot of, you know, policemen, firefighters, doctors, veterinarians, baseball players, basketball players. Tim, release the picture. There was only one lawyer on the wall that day. You'll see it says future naval aviator. I actually have a friend, Matt Dietz, who is a fighter jet pilot. Look at these glasses. That was never going to happen, folks. I am living my purpose. I'm a lawyer. I was known. I was seen. I was understood. It's how he pursued me. So, kids in the room, let me tell you, if you're passionate about something, if you have a dream, if you have a hunger inside you, there's a good chance that sensation is God pursuing you. It was true in my case. The Holy Spirit deposited the purpose behind his design of me in my heart from the time I was a little boy. You see, he knows me better than I know myself. Some of you already know what I'm talking about. Joanne Hummel was telling me earlier in the week when she was a little girl, she used to line up her stuffed animals and teach them. It was something that was deposited in her by the Holy Spirit when she was little. Now, I know what you're thinking. How did this person have time to study with all of his girlfriends? It's actually easier than you would think. Second graders, a little encouragement. All it takes is one. I'm a married lawyer with three children. I'm doing precisely what God designed me to do. But when I was in the second grade, I can remember thinking, I wish God had designed me another way. Heck, I'm 40 years old. There's still times I wish God had designed me another way. That in and of itself is a kind of running from God. Does anybody here struggle with being self-conscious? Just raise your hand if you struggle with that. I do. I got up here for mic check this morning. I was like, is that really what my voice sounds like? I look at the monitor, so I do look like that. What about the other side? Oh, no, that's still me. I remember thinking, gosh, I wish God had made me differently. I look at my children now. My son is tall, and he's handsome, and he's great at sports, and he's coordinated. He's everything I wanted to be when I was a boy. My daughter can dance, and she can draw, and she can paint, and she's elegant and thoughtful. God, why didn't you make me like one of them? Why'd you skip a generation with all of that? Thank God that he runs faster than I do. He pursues faster than I can run away from my design. It's a common thing for us to run from our design. There could be any number of reasons for this in your life or mine. One, fear. Fear of rejection. Fear of failure. You could be running for pride, feeling like we should be doing something better or more significant than what we were designed to do. Why does the whole world run from design? When I was in college, I took an astronomy class, okay? At Harvard in the Science Center, they have this big telescope. It's gigantic. Can't imagine what it costs. But one of the things that it can do is it can measure something called redshift. Does anybody know what redshift is? Redshift is something that can be measured through a telescope, and it tells us how fast an object in the heavens is moving away from the observer. And you can actually measure it and quantify it. Well, what our teaching assistant told us was that those objects are moving away from us at speed because they're still moving from the Big Bang. The universe is constantly expanding, and that object is moving away from us at speed. And of course, the Big Bang being that there was a hyperdense ball of matter at the center of the universe that exploded the universe into existence. And so I asked my teaching assistant, well, where did that hyperdense ball of matter come from? He said, that's all class for today. We're going to reconvene next Wednesday at 8 o'clock in the observatory. I'm joking, of course. It's an oversimplification. There are all kinds of unavailing theories about how that actually happened. But there's a reason we flee from our design. There's a reason the world runs from it. Let me tell you what I think it is. If there's no design, then it goes without saying that there's no designer. If there's no designer, then all is permitted. We can do whatever we want. We can change genders whenever we feel like it. We can leave our marriages for any reason. We can change anything about ourselves that we don't seem to appreciate the way that God appreciated it. But if there is a design, there must have been a designer. And if there was a designer, there must have been a purpose, because no one ever designs anything without a purpose. Some of you in the room here are engineers. I'm looking at one over there. Nothing gets designed without a purpose. And if there's a purpose, there must be a plan that the designer has in mind. So what's the plan? There's a plan. We owe our entire lives to figuring out what the designer is up to. Why is he pursuing us? Why is God pursuing us? Open your Bibles to Psalm 139. This is a psalm that one scholar has titled The Hound of Heaven. And the scholar calls it that because the theme of this psalm is a God who's pursuing us. Not just us in pursuit of him, but a God who's pursuing us. I like to cut to the point. This is a piece of Hebrew poetry. Its likely provenance is King David. Your Bible probably specifically says that it's a Psalm of David. However, not every scholar agrees. Some scholars think that because there are Aramaic words in this original psalm, that it could not have come from David, and it was probably Zechariah who wrote it in the exile. Still, some other scholars believe that it was Job who wrote this psalm. Here's what you need to know for sure about this psalm. It is a piece of poetry written by someone who personally experienced being intimately known and hotly pursued by a transcendent God. That's who wrote this psalm. It's broken into four strophes or stanzas that are six verses long. First six are a section, the second six are a section, and so on. The structure of, and we're not going to get through all of them today, the structure of Psalm 139 is what's called a chiastic structure. This is part of the structure of the type of poetry that's being expressed here. In a chiasm, the verse that's at the center of the chiasm is the point of the scripture. And we have such a structure in Psalm 139. X marks the spot. The chiasm comes to a point in verse 13, and the point of this psalm is that we, you and I, were intentionally formed by a God who reached across time and space to imbue us with the qualities and characteristics that we have. Made a personal choice for you and me. Let's take a look at Psalm 139, verse 13. It says, for you, this is in the NIV, for you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. All right, for those of you who like studying the Bible, I want to give you a tip. This is not the only way to do it, but this is one of the ways that I do it. If I'm studying an Old Testament passage that's written in Hebrew, what I like to do is I like to go and get a Hebrew interlinear Bible that shows the Hebrew word next to the English translation. This is all for free online. You could Google Psalm 139 Hebrew interlinear Bible, and it brings up the Hebrew and English simultaneously. I want to tell you what I discovered when I looked at it this way. It says, for you created my inmost being. Some of your translations may say inward parts. This is a Hebrew word, kiliote, and it is translated a number of different ways throughout the Old Testament. In some places, it's translated heart. In some places, it's translated mind. In another place, it's translated kidneys. This is amazing how the Holy Spirit works. Just this week, I was dealing with, I was talking to one of my law partners who has a son who has kidney function at less than 15% at times. And the message of Psalm 139 to that person is, God actually formed all of those parts for that person. Still another very close friend whose father is in the hospital with borderline kidney failure. God formed those parts. He is the master of them. For you created my inmost being. That word created, or it may say formed in your translation, it's the Hebrew word kanita. And here's what I think you need to know about that verb or that word in Hebrew. In every other place, it is translated purchased or possessed. Here in Psalm 139 in your Bible, it may be translated created or formed, but almost everywhere else, it's used to say purchased or possessed. So here's what I want you to know about the chiasm, the point of Psalm 139. God is saying, a transcendent God who's all-knowing, all-powerful, and all-present, purchased and possessed for himself what's inside you. He bought it for himself. You knit me together in my mother's womb. That Hebrew word knit is often represented covered or weaved. How many of you, and it's actually, the idea is that you're layering something on top of one another. For those of you who knit in the room, you're layering fabric or layering thread on top of one another until you've finished the final product. How many of you know that you have layers? Some of you have layers that you don't particularly like. I know that I have layers that I don't particularly like about myself. But every layer of yourself was individually weaved into your life by a transcendent, all-knowing, all-powerful, all-present God. That's the point of this psalm. You see, God wants what's coming to him. He wants what he bought and paid for. And he'll run as fast as he needs to run to get it. He'll leave the 99 to go after the one. He will spend all of his money to buy the field in which the pearl of great price is buried. He runs out to meet the prodigal, and he'll run out to meet you too. That's the point of this psalm. This verse, for you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb, it is either true or it is not true. Most of the world would say that it's not true. People who haven't met Jesus yet would probably say the universe is a happy accident, that we're products of an evolution that occurred over billions of years. Some people might say, even Christians might say, some people who have met Jesus might believe that God is behind the formation of the universe, but that he directed the process of life and then backs away and is disinterested in what goes on in humanity. This verse espouses a very different belief. What's in you has been placed there specifically for a reason by God. God's love is projected in his design. Okay? Let me give you an example. We have any doctors in the room? Just raise your hand. Got a few doctors. Some of you know what hemoglobin is? Just raise your hand if you ever heard the word hemoglobin before. Okay. Hemoglobin is a compound that's in your blood that permits your blood to take oxygen from the blood to the tissues of your body. Inside hemoglobin, there is one molecule called the alpha globulin molecule, all right? It is a string of amino acids that is 141 amino acids long. There are 20 different naturally occurring amino acids. So that 141 amino acid string is in a specific order to permit oxygen transfer from your blood to your tissues. One molecule. God made it. There is a 1 in 10 to the 183rd power chance that that happened by accident. A combination of 20 amino acids laid out 141 in a row in a specific combination. That the chances of that happening by accident are 1 in 10 to the 183rd power. if Kelly needs something from the grocery store and I have to go three different places to get it, I come back and I'm expecting a ticker tape parade. God went to a trillion different stores to make one molecule in your body. What else does he have to do to convince you that he loves you? What else would he have to do? God's love is expressed in our design and his unique design of you and his design of all of us collectively. But this begs the question, why is he pursuing us? Why didn't he just create us and say, come and find me? Wouldn't that have been much simpler on his part? Just create you and say, come and find me, how I am. Peekaboo, hide and seek. He pursues us. But why is he pursuing us? Why go to all that trouble? Let's look at the first two strophes of Psalm 139. Let's start in verse 1. For the director of music of David, a psalm. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. That term search in Hebrew is a mining term. It's not just a, oh, I'm looking. This is a deep, deep, this is a deep, deep searching of the object here. It says, and you know me. This is a term of intimacy. So God created us. We know that's the point of this psalm. But he is searching us, and he knows us in an intimate way. Verse 2, you know when I sit and when I rise. When I sit and when I rise. This is a literary device called a merism. You guys are familiar with it, even though you may not realize you are. It's designed to project completeness, when I sit and when I rise. We have merisms in the legal world. Last will and testament, to have and to hold, the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. It's a literary device that's designed to suggest completeness. God knows it all. You know when I sit and when I rise, you perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. Another merism, he discerneth all. You are familiar with all my ways. How many of you have had TSA get familiar with all your ways? I have. It's not the most pleasant experience. My friend David Schubert and I have a running joke. It just depends on what country you go to. Sometimes I go to TSA and they're like, well, put your laptop in here and then put your shoes in another bin, put your device, put your phone in still another bin, and just like, before I know, I've got seven bins. You go to another country and they're like, look at that idiot with his shoes off. TSA is different in every country. But the purpose of TSA is so that they can scrutinize what gets on the plane. This word here, where it says, you are familiar with all my ways, the real Hebrew word, the underlying Hebrew word, suggests scrutiny. If you have a New King James version, it probably says scrutinize instead of familiar with. And here's how that applies to us. Some of us get to the point in our life with Jesus where we stop scrutinizing our ideas about immigration, about politics, about healthcare, about national defense, about other social issues around us. The idea behind this verse is that the pursuit of God is an ongoing scrutiny of what we think about everything. That we take our pockets and we empty them before the Lord and we lay them bare and say, would you scrutinize what I think about this? He's familiar with all our ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before. That behind and before is a military term. It has a military connotation. God takes point, and he's our rear guard. And you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. So this first strophe addresses the intimate involvement of God in our lives. He's not remote. He's not remote. He's not dispassionate. He's not disinterested. Not only is he involved, but he's supernaturally involved. Let's read on. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you're there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light will become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. Let me tell you what this is. This is David expressing his intimidation at the level of scrutiny that he gets from God. You can no more run from God than you can run from his design. There is nowhere you can go to get away from his presence, and not that you should want to, but you simply can't. I've read this psalm countless times, but I want to tell you what the Holy Spirit zeroed in on with me this time around. This psalm means something different for us on this side of the cross. Let me explain what I mean. The motif or the milieu in which David was doing life was, God, it's you and me versus the world. God gives David the truth, the law to follow. David follows it as best as he can. God, I'm in partnership with you. Everyone else is a problem. On this side of the cross, things are different. Things are different. Here's what I zeroed in on. Verse 12, it's the last verse leading into the point of the psalm. Even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. Jesus says in John 8:12, I am the light of the world. And then in Matthew 5, Jesus says to his disciples, you are the light of the world. What gives? Jesus says, I'm the light of the world. And then he tells his disciples, you are the light of the world. How does that make any sense? Does that mean that the Bible's inconsistent or these two passages are incongruent with one another? In Ephesians 5:8, it says, at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Are we going to hide our light under a bushel? Let me try that again. Surely you've heard the song before. Hide your light under a bushel?
No.
I'm gonna. Thank you. We're not gonna hide our light under a bushel. I wanna submit to you, this is why God is pursuing you. This is why God is pursuing me. It's because, listen, in Jesus, we own the night. Let me say that again. In Jesus, we own the night. I don't get to say, oh, it's dark over there, I don't need to go. In Jesus, we own the night. Let me explain what I mean. It's exactly where he wants his design, his unique purpose that's expressed through you. He wants it in dark places. That's where it shines the brightest. Joanne told us earlier in this series about how there are two tracks of discussion in each psalm. The perspective of the worshiper and the discussion of the God being worshiped. The benefit we have on this side of the cross is that we are fully indwelt by a God for whom darkness is not dark. There's a convergence that happens. The characteristics of the worshiped we begin to adopt when we're indwelt by his Holy Spirit on this side of the cross. I want to tell you that I think you've been done a disservice in evangelicalism. Let me give you an example, a real life example from my life. So when I think I was in high school, does anybody remember the boycott of Disney? Yes, raise your hand if you remember that. It was in the kind of mid-1990s. The church says, we're going to boycott Disney because of a stance that they take on a social issue. And so the church goes, we're not going over there. That's too dark. Let me propose to you the idea that the places that are, quote, too dark are exactly the places that we as believers should be influencing because we're indwelt by the person for whom darkness is not dark. We own those places. The message that's been relayed to Christians, us, is that certain mountains of culture are too dark for you to be involved in. Well, you wouldn't want to send your son to Harvard. That's a godless place. Mostly true, maybe a bad example. But the principle still applies. If Christians say, I'm not going to that mountain of culture because it's too dark, who's gonna go? You wouldn't wanna send your kid to Hollywood or Nashville or the mainstream media or, God forbid, politics. Those places are too dark. We just haven't been told enough that we're indwelt by a God for whom darkness is not dark. You actually are the light of the world. You own the night. Let me give you some examples from our body. So I have a dear friend in our Frisco body, Jairus Pascal. Here's what he does for a living. He makes movies and he puts on heavy metal shows. And he desperately loves Jesus. We have another friend in our body here, Chris Cantero. He animates video games, violent video games where aliens get blown up, and he desperately loves Jesus. They're in those mountains of culture because that's God's design. His design is expressed in their unique purpose, and he's part of the same plan as you to own the night. We have another member of our body, Kevin Falconer. He's in politics. He's the mayor of our city. He goes to city council meetings. I'm sure dark things are discussed there, but if he's not there, if not him, then who? If not you, then who? Who is going to be in those places and transforming them by Christ's Holy Spirit? How does it look for me as a lawyer? It's very simple. I look for broken things and I fix them. We go into the darkened places, we look for broken things, and we fix them. What do we do with this information? Listen to me. Parents, Pine Cove counselors, aunts, uncles, grandparents, I want you to do something for me. I want you to have a conversation with the young people in your life and say, this is what makes you unique. This is what I see God doing in you. This is how I see God's purpose that is unique to you being expressed in you. I have a word for this. I call it making a deposit. You remember that picture, that embarrassing picture I showed you earlier? The Holy Spirit deposited that in my life. My parents never walked up to me and said, oh, you'd make such a great lawyer one day. Didn't happen like that. The Holy Spirit deposited that in my life. But let me tell you something. You don't get off the hook. The Holy Spirit is not the only person who's making deposits. He actually entrusted that job to us to co-labor with him in the lives of others. Kids, I want you to do something. I want you to turn to your parents. I want you to grab their hand. And I want you to ask them, would you make a deposit in me about my design? Can you imagine what it would look like if a child looked up at you and said, wow, you really think that about me? There's power in calling it forth. Some of you were born to run. Some of you were born to do financial things. Some of you were born to be chemical engineers. And there's purpose in it. If there's something internal to you that says, by God, I'm supposed to be in that courtroom. By God, I'm supposed to be in that boardroom. By God, I'm supposed to be in that laundry room. It doesn't matter what the room is. God's unique design of you expresses a purpose so that he can go in those rooms where no one else gets to go in you. He gets to go in those rooms that no one else gets to go in through you. Now, what about the rest of us who aren't kids? Does anyone just feel like you want to stop running? Just raise your hand if you want to stop running from your design. I want to stop running from mine. I feel that self-consciousness that creeps over. I still have moments where I go, God, I wish you had made me differently. Taller, smarter, better looking, whatever it is. I know that you feel it too. The way that we stop running is this. Let him catch you. Just let him catch you. Let his design take over. Let him scrutinize your ways. Ask him if there's something in you that he wants to change. If there's something in you that he wants to do differently. Let him enclose you before and behind. He's dying to do it. In fact, he died to do it. In Colossians, it tells us this is the mystery that's been that is to be revealed from generation to generation, Christ in you, the hope of glory. On David's side of the cross, he never got to hear about the mystery. Your advantage is you do. Your advantage is you do. It's Christ in us, the hope of glory, that makes our motif, it makes our milieu different. If you're ready to be caught by this God who's chasing you, come and let us introduce you to him. If you need prayer for God to show you his purpose and your design, come and let us pray for you. Would y'all stand? Let me pray over you and commission you. Heavenly Father, you made each and every one of us uniquely. You're not just involved in our lives, you're supernaturally involved. Layer upon layer was your choice. You bought us for yourselves. You bought everything in us. There's no error in our design. You made us just the way you intended for us to be. Lord, I just pray over us as a body that you would imbue us with the courage we need to carry out your purpose, to not run from you in fear, to not run out of pride. Lord, make a deposit. You're still making deposits in my life. There is no one in this room who is too old not to get a deposit from you. Heavenly Father, I ask that you would do a supernatural work to give us direction individually. Lord Jesus, lay out your purpose so that we can be part of a plan, part of your plan, Lord. Put us in the rooms where you want to go, and then embolden us by your Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen.